Straight out. The manager came running up to me and she was like, Kevin, have you got your RSA?
Now I told you I'm from the Republic of South Africa. Love.
No stress. No worries. Responsible service of alcohol certificate. You really need one to work in this kind of environment. It's like,
I'm being very responsible, love. South African man. No, I'm being very responsible, right? These are only doubles. You want to see a triple out of the two.
Kevin Fraser, welcome back. Oh my goodness, it's been 12 months. Yeah, it's been 12 months. Another interview, another airport. What's going on?
I'm the definition of Oorsee vandag because I'm Oorsee somewhere here in Hong Kong. But yeah, it's been 12 months.
Yeah, 12 months since our first interview. And you've been busy. I mean, you've been touring the world. I mean, when last time we spoke, you were in New Zealand, currently awaiting to, I think you were on your way to Melbourne, actually. You were either on your way to Melbourne or shopping for a jacket because you were on your way to Melbourne, something like that.
probably shopping for a jacket on my way to Melbourne.
So tell us, what have you been busy with in the past 12 months?
Yeah, it's nonstop. Hey, touring's just been taking over and really, really, really chuffed about that. So we obviously had just recently I had a big New Zealand tour that was epic. Before that, we were in Asia for the first time. That was really, really cool. That was a learning experience and just trying to test the waters there. So we had a really, really good time and also did the UK, Africa, and my first regional African tour, which was also such an experience. Went to Botswana, Swatini, Mauritius for the first time, got caught in a cyclone in Mauritius. So that was also, yeah, there's always something on tour that you can take away with you, even if it's a coconut that fell.
So tell us a bit. So you've been doing Africa as a feeling.
Yes, taking that feeling everywhere.
So tell us, how's the audience been responding to that? Because one thing that I've been at your Melbourne show, and what I realized was you were focused mainly on South African local things, but you were adapting your show to the country that you're in, which I think is really clever. I mean, you're sort of engaging with the audience, because I mean, I was in that audience and there was loads of Aussies there as well.
Yeah, it is. I mean, it's a gamble, right? I mean, we've just as I'm sitting here in Hong Kong, I've just finished my Canadian tour. So it was the first show I ever did. I got off stage in Toronto and I went straight to the airport and I did a 15-hour flight. So I probably won't do that again. But it's been such an interesting point to reflect on, because this tour, Africa's a Feeling, that's now coming to Australia next month, is the same sort of tour that we've been doing throughout Canada. And, you know, every time I get to Canada, it's so far removed from the rest of the world. You think to yourself, what kind of things can I include to chat about? And I think it's always about trying to find the balance between what people want to hear and see, and then a bit of the local banter. So after 5-6 days in Canada, I was finding so many things that I just had to speak about that can be appreciated on both sides of the fence. And I think that it's also about how you structure something to give context and reference, I suppose, for what you're about to speak about, even if someone doesn't know that experience based on having come from Africa, you can set it up so that they can understand.
There's a couple of universal trademarks from Africa that you can just always joke about, and even local people in South Africa would find it really funny, because they're obviously there. And but I mean, traveling the world, look, I lived in Victoria for a month and I was already joking about the politics. The one thing I just never can joke about is things like potholes and those sorts of things, because there's one pothole in this entire highway out here and the Victorians would go crazy on Facebook. They'd be tagging the council left, right and center. And I'm like, just relax.
You've got to find something to complain about.
You have no idea what to really complain about. Now,
it's my favorite thing about Australian news, when you see like Nine News or whatever come out with something and they'll be like, sources say X, Y, Z, and you wonder if they're just making up news for the sake of trying to find something topical for the day.
Absolutely. Even now, I'm not shooting down the crime. There is crime in Australia, but obviously not to the same containers as in South Africa. But the smallest thing hits the headlines. And I'm like, oh my goodness, that's a Tuesday in Cape Town.
Don't even make paper seven in South Africa. Yeah,
absolutely. Now, traveling the world the last 12 months, you gave us a bit of a run on where you've been everywhere. How is all the traveling and engaging with these different audience? How has your show adapted in the past 12 months? What can we expect when we see you in Melbourne?
Yeah, exactly. Hey, I mean, you're always growing, I think, with every bit of opportunity that you have to get back on stage. And I think that my show is, you know, I wouldn't say it's changed entirely in its format, because people come to experience what they expect of me, so that'll never change, and I don't want that to change. But I would say, content wise I always find that whenever I walk off stage, there's still so much more I wanted to say and fit in. So now I'm finding ways to compact that in a better format to deliver a completely fresh set of jokes. Look, the Africa's a Feeling tour is definitely a nostalgic one. It definitely takes people back to a lot of things that they may have missed from an expat's point of view, for sure. But there's just my everyday hilarious spin on stuff, I guess, that's to be experienced. And particularly in Melbourne this year, we've been chasing one of my favorite venues for a long time. So we're finally out in St. Kilda. So I'm very excited about that. Wow. The environment for your shows as well is also hugely a big factor in how it goes down. Because I mean, last time I didn't expect the turnout that came. It was crazy.
I was sitting way in the back. I had to I didn't get,
we'll put front, you closer this time, Steve.
I didn't get front row tickets. I was sitting there next to other people, like, yeah, I've met him.
I'm at the back, but I did meet him.
They had to carry chairs from the venue next door in order to get me and my wife seated. It's okay. All forgiven. Now, you're not doing just Melbourne, obviously. I'm focused on Melbourne because I'm down here, but Oorsee is worldwide and definitely Australia-wide. So tell us a bit, what other venues around Australia will you be covering as well?
Yeah, sure. So we are starting in Melbourne, so that's epic. And then I'll be in Brisbane at the Brisbane Showgrounds. That's also going to be epic. Perth, we're in the Regal Theatre this year. Beautiful venue there. And then where else am I going? Sydney, couldn't forget that. We have the Masonic Centre in Sydney. Beautiful space there. And then Adelaide after that, yeah. So I know people have been screaming for regional. We're doing regional next year. So just the big cities at the moment, yeah.
Bairnsdale. where regional are you going to be? Yeah.
People don't even want to leave the Gold Coast to go to Brisbane, so you have to come to them. This is the thing, right? People are living all over the place now, so they want you to keep coming down to them. I mean, we learned that lesson in New Zealand. Unbelievable how spread out people are.
We just came from there. We go every year. We sort of go to decide, are we moving yet? But it's hard because everything's so far away. It's like moving out of country, moving into state. So we did Gold Coast last year, did some SeaWorld and Paradise Resort, and then we went to Sunshine Coast, which I absolutely fell in love with. I mean, if I have to give up Victoria for any place, it'll be that. And Noosa, oh my goodness, I could just,
yeah, it's a beautiful spot. I lived there for a while, and I think that's the tough thing for people, is because so many families and friends have all had recommendations of where to move to, where to live. And when people have immigrated out of South Africa, for example, they make that one move, say it's Melbourne in your case, and maybe they learn 2 years into their journey that perhaps they should have gone to another side of the country or different, and to have to pick up and move all of that again is just such a big decision.
I was betrayed.
You don't want to go through that.
I feel betrayed. I'm sorry. I lived in London. I was living the dream, you know. I was in that full-on Harry Potter experience, and then I was told, no, this place sucks, it's cold, let's go to a warmer place. And then we came to Melbourne. I'm like,
Well, I don't know who gave you the advice then.
Nah, my wife.
But hey, at least you're sipping on some of the best coffee in the Southern Hemisphere, because Melbourne knows how to do that.
That's true. I've already had two. I'm on rooibos now. rooibos tea. All right. So now, one thing that I noticed in your travels. Now, you know, I work closely with SA Events, and whenever they bring artists over, I often go and pick them up at the airport. And it's always a bit of a rush. So I drive to the airport, I grab. So I had the privilege of picking up Nathaniel and two of his the guys that were traveling with him, Floers, which is a famous guitarist for Afrikaans, Groot, and Skalk, who's a famous pianist. But if you know of Nathaniel, you know you don't just go picking up in any car. Unfortunately, I drive a bucky. I'm telling you, and I've got two small children. If I didn't stop half an hour before the airport, he would be chewing on old knickknacks and stuff that was lying on the back seat.
Why be that guy?
Well, no, not that guy. But anyway, the point of the story is they always in a rush. So they literally get off the airport, they go to the venue, they do the show, hurry back to the hotel early next morning. They're on another flight. They go. You, on the other hand, I see you cruising the streets of Canada, all kinds of stuff. So you obviously get to spend time with the people. You get to know these people. Now, just mention three of the most memorial memories that you've made globally, because you just said you've seen places you've never been before that you can fall back on and you can recall, and then something that we can share with that Oorsee audience that they can tell their friends and get them prepared for the next time that you go over there.
Yeah, 100%. Jeez, that's a good one, because that's exactly what I do. And just to try and avoid that anxiety around airports, rushing travel, this, and you're never present, you know. The whole I did that when I was a DJ, and it got horrible. So I said, that's not a life I want to live. So I try and give myself at least 48 hours in a city before. I mean, even just now when we're in Alberta in Canada for the show in Calgary, I was invited to, and that's only because I allowed myself a couple of days there, right? I didn't know what the weather was going to be like, didn't know what to expect. I got invited to a Canadian barbecue style. And I said, okay, well, what's a Canadian barbecue? It's just like a braai, but like, you know, you guys have gas. But no,
Moose.
because of the amalgamation between Canadians and South Africans at this braai, they had this proper bonfire situation. I said, okay, so someone from bloody Pretoria is teaching you how to do this or whatever. And but then the one Canadian was there on standby with his hose pipe, and he kept hosing down the fire. So I was like, well, what's the point of this? Are we trying to keep warm, but you're cooling us down? Like, what's the story? And he said, well, look around you, mate. The whole house is made of bloody drywall and cardboard in this side of the world. So, you know, one stray briquette, and that whole house is going down within seconds.
Up in
But
flames.
between experiencing that and then having to go outside via the basement and passing snow scoops, you realize that yes, you're on the other side of the world experiencing how other people live and engage in their own culture, but also that we're all just the same. You know, we want the same things out of life, and that we're all pretty similar. It's just how the cookie crumbles for people in the different environments they live. So that's been an incredible part of the journey, and something I can take away. It's just how similar we are, yet different, you know. I'd also say that on my recent tour that we did in New Zealand, I still haven't quite got the nod to go through to Hobbiton, which is like where I've always wanted to go and experience how they made the Lord of the Rings, right? Because even without going, I've come to believe that I think that's how a lot of New Zealanders actually live.
Oh
Just
my goodness.
nestled in their own hills there. It's just crazy how different worlds can be, but so similar at the same time. And that's why I think I end up also choosing to spend a lot more time in these places. It's the only way you build, you know.
No, absolutely. I mean that's how you craft your content. I'm always curious. I mean, you guys go on stage. Now, I'm no stranger to public speaking. I do a few events around here as well, and I'm always sort of the speaker, and I'm always so nervous in the end, like it drives me crazy. But something happens between that first step you give on stage and when you grab the mic and you start talking. And I think it's because I picture everyone naked. I think that's probably part of it, but I'm not sure. So how do you have your arms written in little notes, or do you memorize all your acts? How do you just it's because it must
Yeah.
come so naturally. Well, give us
Well,
this.
yeah, I
We
think
want to
you
know.
have to have yeah, I mean, like the stage time in general that I've had to be able to practice just in general in front of people, whether it was as a DJ before my comedy career, whether it was just doing presenting workshops and all of that, just having to nail that home is essential, I guess, prior to even getting onto like a ticketed platform to do shows. But for me personally, to answer you, like when I go on, the moment I go on, I don't know, it's just a different world for me, and it's just how I connect. And I think you can either have that ability or you don't. I mean, last night in Toronto was actually an interesting example, because it was a very seamless show. It doesn't happen every time where you don't have a hiccup before, or you know, there's so much that happens in showbiz that you rely on in order to be successful on stage. But we were super happy. Everything was on time. Everything was chuffed. And I'm sitting backstage at like 5 to 8 and now I'm ready. And it's those 5 minutes before I go on where I'm kind of like, okay, like let's just breathe. Let's just woozle. I'm doing like 300 different P's before I go on stage. But then at the same time, I'm like, let's just get on. Like I'm in a space where I need to get on now. So actually, come like 8:05, nobody's come backstage to give me my microphone. Nobody's done the final 3 minute, you know, like just be here by the curtain. Because other than that, it's actually quite boring backstage, right? So it's got to 8:15 and I can feel the audience energy, like, where's Kevin? And I'm also like, yes, like get me on stage, like I'm ready. So my eSIM decided to run out at that flippin' moment. So I'm like, I've got no one to talk to. My team, everyone's at different parts. So what does the South African in me do? I'm like, yes, like, what must I do now, guys? Like, I don't know what to do. So I turn around and I see, and I'm on the third floor. The theater's on like the ground floor. That's where my green room was. I see this sign that just says emergency exit. So I kick this door down and like, I find this rusted staircase going down to the bottom, and I'm running down. Now I found my way back to the entrance of the whole theater, and the main person was standing there, and I'm like, can we start the bloody show? But they'd never seen like my attitude and my mood had changed so fast that I actually had to apologize afterwards. I said, listen, I was in my zone, I was in my safe space, and that got rattled before I went on stage. I needed you to start the show on time. So I think for my team, they learn very quickly like where my breaking points are there, just because I go into this zone before I go on. Yeah.
You know, it would have been really funny if he didn't know who you were and you didn't have a ticket to be there.
Exactly. Exactly.
In headline news. Oh, Kevin, We love you. We love seeing your videos online. It's just, every time something pops up on my phone, I always sit and watch it, and it always makes me chuckle. I mean, personally, you won't catch me dancing on stage. it's not my thing, but you do it so well, and it gels perfectly in with your acting. And look, I'm going to say it for what it is. Stand-up comedy is a true art, and I personally believe you need to be a genius to stand there and run a show for an hour or 2 hours, and just somehow in the middle of your act, despite preparing, also adapt. And like you said, in a nutshell, traveling is the cure for ignorance. And the more you travel, the better your content will be as well. So exactly. Thank you so much for your time. It looks like you've got some guests there behind you. Tell them on Oorsee.
Yeah, it's all happening in Hong Kong. I'm definitely Oorsee.
Well, thank you so much. We're going to be putting this video out and make sure that everyone knows you're on your way. You're on your way home. And we can't wait to experience the feeling with you, if you know what I mean.
Excellent. We'll see you in Melbourne, Steve. Thanks so much.
Yes, thank you so much.